Wheezy.
Kate, I think, has made extraordinary progress.
Is it getting better?
I would hope that we will continue to improve her ballet skill and maybe one day so that she can walk independently.
Will it make it easier on you now?
That's very good. It is.
Courtney is interesting too, because everyone thinks of brain injury as kids that can't move. But her higher levels of the brain, the intellectual parts of the brain, aren't working as well as they should. In the night, one love. David is the opposite to Courtney. I mean, he's a smart little kid. He understands exactly what's going on. But he has a lot of problems controlling his body. Ariel is an interesting case because we started so young.
There we go.
Now that we've got her moving by herself, hopefully that will start off that whole developmental process. It looked like he was doomed to spend the rest of his life in a wheelchair. I mean, that's what you'd expect if you saw someone like Rick. He can actually move by himself. He can roll, he can tummy crawl. We've made him mobile.
The man on the move is Australian therapist Ian Hunter. Every 3 months, he packs his wares and crosses the Tasman to assess and treat the 50 Kiwi kids currently in his care. A travelling man selling hope and an alternative neurological therapy for children who've suffered a brain injury. What's different about Ian Hunter's approach is that the therapy takes place at home, not in a hospital. The parents, not the professionals, are the therapists, and the sky is the limit.
They told us to expect the worst, that she may never move, she may never crawl, she may never be able to feed herself, might have to be fed with a tube. She might never be able to, she might be cortically blind, she basically a nothing.
You know, for parents to be told at 7 days, when the baby is 7 days old, that you've got to expect the worst. My God, I mean, most parents would take a long, long time to recover from that. My role is to say, okay, yes, it has happened, it is a terrible thing, but let's not dwell on that. Because we can't measure that potential, the only way we're going to find out is by trying to develop it. Let's put all our energy into doing that and seeing what happens.
In the 17 months that Ariel's been on Ian's program, she's made good progress. She now crawls, she can feed normally, and even shows signs of wanting to walk.
Initially, she tends to be a bit stiff-legged.
One, two, three.
This may look pretty unusual. It's a technique Ian Hunter calls patterning. There are parts of little Ariel's brain that were injured at birth. The idea now is to activate and teach the uninjured parts of her brain how to perform even the simplest of tasks, like crawling. This therapy is designed to program the brain in just the same way as any normal human development. And we're told it doesn't hurt her. Good girl.
Think of how much movement a baby makes. They crawl all over the place. They do lots of movement activities. If it takes that much to develop a normal brain, we know that there is a relationship, because we know if they don't do it, their brains don't develop normally. If it takes that much, then to me it's very obvious what you have to do with a brain injured child.
Ian believes that movement is the key that unlocks the brain.
No,
Ariel's uninjured brain cells are being taught everything that might come naturally to a normal baby.
She's actually got that toe dig, which is often hard for them to learn.
She has up to 4 hours a day of intensive physical therapy, and as far as mum and dad are concerned, it's working. What are you hoping for?
What every parent does, I suppose. She's a happy kid, and she's happy. She's happy, and that's all we really want. We love her and she loves us.
Given the pessimistic prognosis for Ariel by the doctors when she was 7 days old, is Ariel a miracle?
I never refer to any of the children that I deal with as miracles, because a miracle implies it's just something that happens. All the progress that these children achieve are not through miracles, it's through damned hard work.
Oh boy, good arms.
You know, it's the strangest looking exercise, isn't it? I mean, perhaps the most disturbing for anybody who doesn't understand what's going on here. When you first saw it, were you concerned at all about it?
Oh, absolutely. The first week or two that we did this, every time we hung him upside down, I kept thinking, if he falls out, we're going to have a bigger brain injury, you know. But as soon as he started doing this, his balance was improving, and, you know, it was just worth it.
And what's really nice is when he turns his head, his whole body changes. So
when David Batten was born, his parents were told he could have cerebral palsy, or worse still, be a vegetable. So they tried every sort of therapy on offer. But like so many other parents of brain-injured children, Linda was never told about Ian's program.
I heard about Ian's program through just happening to turn the radio on at the right time. So as he talked about children just like David, I thought, oh boy, I've got to go and listen to this. When I went to his speech, everything he said made sense. As I said before, you never know until you try it, but it all made sense. It sounded right, and I went home and said, we've got to do this.
Conventional therapy has trained therapists, but your program, you hand over the therapy to the parents. Isn't there some danger in that?
First of all, they're parents, so they're not untrained. They're highly qualified as parents. Secondly, what we're talking about is a therapy program, because it's based on normal development, is really very simple to carry out. There are no really fancy, unusual things to do, because if you look at normal development, I mean, it's so simple, a child can do it itself. I learned a long time ago to have enormous respect for parents. They're not silly, they love their child, and if you treat them properly and respect them, you can, in fact, turn them into excellent therapists who do a wonderful job.
The next thing Linda knew, she was her son's new therapist. But how do you manage a program that demands so much time and obviously more than two pairs of hands?
Or an extra hand. One of the biggest fears is, how on earth are we going to get people to come into our home? Because they have been so isolated. But I always say to them, look, I know it seems impossible, but in most cases, it's the least of your problems. And what they discover is it really isn't such a bad world out there. There really are lots of loving and caring people.
How did you find all the volunteers, Linda?
With much effort, actually, and they're like gold nuggets. They really are.
Through newspaper articles and posters, Linda found 38 volunteers to help out.
Wonderful, look at that.
That's the key to Ian Hunter's vision. Motivated and loving parents running a therapy program from home, fully supported by their community.
The prognosis was that we just take him home and he will be what he will be. And he will be what he'll be, but we'll make sure he's what he can be.
Up and down the country, the families and their volunteers gather for Ian's reassessment. Wherever he goes, he devises a new program and leaves a blueprint for what is hopefully the next stage for each of these special children.
This is the gold medal for the best program I've ever seen you do. The gold medal. Hang on.
Hello.
Congratulations.
Give him a shake.
Shake his hand.
Well done. Fantastic. You won the gold medal for New Zealand.
If it all makes so much sense, and it does, why is it considered to be so controversial?
Good question. I've often asked that myself, because the thing that struck me when I first started this work was the logic behind it and the simplicity. I think the controversy is that I'm forcing people to change their view of brain injury. That I'm forcing them to extend their horizons beyond this narrow view that we have of brain injury being a finite, definite thing from which you can't recover.
That's the message Ian is taking into the home and now institutions like the Templeton Centre near Christchurch.
We've all got socks on, socks. Socks.
It's Ian's treatment of Rick Godfrey that started a small revolution in the way brain-injured children were being treated at this institution.
Hats!
When I first saw him 8 months ago, he had really very little control over his body. His arms were sort of flying up, he couldn't really reach out, he wasn't mobile. And it looked like he was doomed to spend the rest of his life in a wheelchair.
Today, Rick doesn't need gravity to help him crawl. He can get around just fine all by himself.
There you are. Well done.
Nice, more again.
Before his bike accident, as a normal, healthy boy, Rick was a regular visitor to the centre. His sister Jane has been here since she was 3 and a half. It's a cruel twist of fate that's seen this little visitor become another patient. Staff had already grown to know and love Rick, so they couldn't give up on him. When his parents found Ian, the therapy found new followers.
Do I love you? Do I?
Something quite magical has come out of all this, according to unit manager Christine Varley. It all happened when they started asking for volunteers to help out with Rick's program.
The response was magnificent, and you sometimes feel that people out there are not really wanting to help other people in this day and age, but certainly not so.
Look at that.
And everyone's been surprised by Rick's progress.
Standing all by yourself. Look, everyone. Fantastic. Excellent. Show me the word that talks about the most handsomest boy in New Zealand.
Before Ian came along, nobody would dream of Rick being able to do this. Reading was not a priority.
So you're handsome and modest at the same time.
The reading, that's often was sort of left because we were dealing with other things we saw as being more important. But now you'll see all these flashcards around the place and everybody's sort of learning, having the opportunity to learn to read.
There's no doubt Ian's therapy has changed Rick's life and life inside the Templeton Centre.
There are times I wonder why and how I can do it, but then I see children like Rick and all the other children we've seen this week who are progressing and who now have more potential than they seem to have had in the past. And I realise that it's something that I can't stop even if I wanted to, because there obviously is a need for it.
Happy birthday, dear Eleanor. Happy birthday to you.
And the need in New Zealand is growing. Ian's newest recruit is Eleanor Tippett. Eleanor's family was told once again to expect the worst when she was hit by a car earlier this year. She spent 3 months in a coma, then months in residential care. Her parents have never given up. They aroused her out of her darkness, and now they're keen to give her a fighting chance to enjoy her life.
Ow, that hurts!
Ian's therapy echoes their own hopes that Eleanor can one day leave the institution she now lives in and be treated at home.
Very tight.
The therapy Ian offers isn't for everyone. It asks a great deal from patient and parents. With no guarantee of success, the Tippetts still feel like it'll all be worth it.
That it's going to be very hard for us with the other children, but I'm sure we'll find a way.
We're talking about literally thousands of children in New Zealand who have brain injury. Now imagine if you pick up a newspaper tomorrow and the headline on the front page was, thousands of New Zealand children have AIDS. My God, a natural disaster. The country's falling to bits. And there'd be so much done to solve this horrible problem. And yet, I could write a headline for the paper tomorrow that says thousands of New Zealand children have brain injury. And what are we doing?